That was not correct. So I think now it should work. Good morning, good afternoon, and maybe even good evening to you all. And welcome to our webinar today on biotherapeutics characterization. Well, yes, welcome once again. And thank you very much for joining us this morning or your afternoons and evenings here. For having a look what we are doing at USP there to develop new standards in that field. Before we start, let me introduce my colleagues that are also in the back today supporting me while I'm presenting the slides in a moment. So I have my colleague Dr. Ranjan Chakrabarty with me, who is our Vice President for Scientific Outreach on the biologics for at USP. And I also have my colleague, Dr. Anu Upal, with me, backing me up today. She is with me in the scientific affairs team at USP, and she is the scientific affairs manager for Southeast Asia with a special focus on the biologics. My name is Christian Seine. I am the scientific affairs manager for the EMEA region, and I'm very happy to present these slides today to you and getting supported by Dr. Anu and Dr. Ranjan from our offices in India. Okay, so I think let's go into detail directly. Let's start. We will do a quick introduction of you. Before we then dive directly into the characterization of biotherapeutics. And there we will also talk a little bit about critical quality attributes and then about the test methods that are closely connected then to those CQAs and also the USP resources that we have. And then afterwards, I would like to introduce you to our new monoclonal antibody reference standards that we have set up. Three new monoclonal antibodies we have there. And we will also discuss about USP future standards then as well at the end. Okay, so yeah, let's start with our USP and the 200 years of building trust. So in 1820 we were founded, as you will probably all know, and back at that time the USP was a single recipe book where recipes were set up how you can make certain medicines. And 220, well, yes, 220 is a special year for all of us, but for us now, 220 marks our 200th anniversary. 2020 marks our 200th anniversary, where we have now procedures and acceptance criteria in place in all the documentary standards, together with the reference standards there to support the medicinal articles in the marketplace, and of course not just in biologics but also in the field, and much more at the moment still in the field of small molecules, which is also the area where I am coming from. So that is how we evolved over time, and also in the next years, hopefully in the next centuries, we will evolve further and go, of course, with what the way medicine is progressing like. The way that medicine progressing like is going, we will evolve in the same way. So with that quick introduction of USP, let's go into detail here. So when we look at biotherapeutics characterization, you will all know that that biotherapeutics, and here we see a monoclonal antibody illustrated. They are very, very complex molecules. So the characterization is involving a number of techniques at all levels at which you can look on such a molecule. For example, when you look at the primary structure first, then comes the secondary and even the tertiary structure there, the higher order structures. So that is where we need to look at. We also have a lot of modification that the protein is undergoing once it leaves the ribosomes and the reticulum, when it is excreted from there and going then outside of the cell. On this way, there's a lot of so-called post-translational modifications. A few of those are also mentioned here on the slide, and we will go to that in a little bit detail afterwards once again. So we have deamidation, oxidation. We have the carbon and the nitrogen variants, like lysine truncation there, and pyroglutamate formation. And very, very important is also, we will come to that later once again as well, the carbohydrate structure, the composition, the glycolization, so to say, because that is very important for determining at the end the immunogenicity of your monoclonal antibody. So it's very, you see, and then we come also to the biological activity, which are total different beasts than all together. And so we will not talk too much about biological activity tests today, but go more into other CQAs. But CQAs, I mentioned it now, it's very important that you have CQAs in place that are describing what you want to achieve, what your molecule is. For that, you need then standards, which we provide, documentary standards, and to some extent, then also reference standards. A quick word to critical quality attributes to CQAs. When you look into the QA guideline from ICH, then it is there, the definition that it is a physical, a chemical, biological, or microbiological property or a characteristic for which you have to set up an appropriate limit and a range or a distribution to make sure that your product is in the end always having the desired quality. So that's an important feature, not just for biologics, also for small molecules, but for biologics. The list of CQAs is, of course, much, much higher. Here is a kind of selection of common CQAs and also then test methods for monoclonal antibodies. So we test on the aggregation. We have the attribute of the aggregation, and we will see later that this is done with size exclusion chromatography, for example. Also maybe with gel electrophoresis and even analytical ultracentrifugation, but we will have an example for size exclusion. I mentioned already glycolization, very important. There is also sialic acid. We will come to that once again later. And then I mentioned the lysine truncation already, deamidation and then pyroglutamate formation. These are all charge variants. We will see how we look on the charge variants as well with the slides later. And then oxidation and also process-related impurities, about we will not talk too much today here. But CQAs, these are CQAs here, and it's very important to have then public standards for the test methods that are supporting the CQAs. So that's where we are heading to. That is what USP is always attempting to set up public standards that you can use, not just for biological medicinal products, but here, of course, today we talk about that. So the benefits of public standards for biological medicine product is that it promotes transparency. There's then clearance about the whole region, what the quality should look like, what the limits are there. And it's also a first step towards international regulatory convergence there. So we are still in the pharma area. We're still far away from getting something that is accepted and registered in Europe to get accepted also without any problem in America or in other parts of the world. We are getting to that, but we are still somewhat apart from that. But these public standards are the first steps to that and promote the international regulatory convergence. And we also have then there the topics of quality, because then quality is set and it should look like that always in the same way. And in that way, it's supporting really the access to high quality products worldwide. So in the way that we provide the standards there and enable then multiple manufacturers to follow that. So not every manufacturer need to set up their own standards once again. No, that is what we do with the public standards. And in the end, as you can see it here also, as the last sentence on the slide, in the end, it is all helping then to ensure patient access to quality medicinal products. And today we are talking about quality biological medicinal products. So coming back to the CQAs and then now the USP resources that we have there. We mentioned already the attribute of aggregation. And when you look into Q6B, into the guideline there for specification of medicines, also for biological medicines, aggregation is in the field of identity and purity. We have there as the USP resource, the chapter 12.9 or 129 there on the analytical procedures for recombinant therapeutic monoclonal antibodies. Also in that area, the glycolization 129 also talks about parts of glycolization, gives there an insight into that. But the more specific glycolization chapters that we have is the chapter 212 on oligosaccharide analysis, the chapter 210 for the monosaccharide analysis. We will touch these topics once again a little bit later. And also important is, although it is above 1,000, and as you probably know, all the general chapters below 1,000 are, so to say, enforceable chapters. The FDA can enforce these chapters. Those chapters above 1,000 are so-called informational chapters. But also very often the regulators are referring to that. And a very important informational chapter is the chapter 1084 on the glycoprotein and the glycan analysis general considerations, and giving you also some ideas of strategies how you can check on the glycolization on your molecules, your monoclonal antibodies there in more detail. We will come to that also a little bit later once again with a specific slide. And then we have some further chapters here, the applications of mass spectrometry and the peptide mapping to check here on the truncations, on the deamidations, pyroglutamate formation there. These things we have in the chapters 1055 explained, and 1736 gives a vast overview about the applications of mass spectrometry also in the biological field. And then about process-related impurities, we have the chapter on residue DNA testing below 1,000, and then also about above 1,000 for the host cell protein measurements. So with that quick introduction into what we have already as public standards for biologics, I would like now to get into more detail and talk about our new reference standards that we have for monoclonal antibodies. They are out since summer, and they are standalone reference standards. They are this time not associated with a monograph or a chapter. You will see later that we have analyzed those and provide information that we have achieved by using these chapters on our antibodies there, on our new antibodies. But they themselves are not associated to a certain monograph or a chapter. So they include a very detailed characterization package, each one. And I will send out later this presentation, and there will be links to the certificates so that you can see what we are providing there. And the customers can have then a look on those characterization packages and can choose then there the map which is best meeting their needs based on the characteristics of their own product that they have. And these standards, they can provide support for almost all stages in, not the clinical stages so much, but all stages during drug development. Especially, of course, QC release and the stability monitoring and developing methods for that testing. That is, of course, the main features or the main fields where our maps can be used. So let's have a closer look into those monoclonal antibodies. I mentioned already that I give the link. So in the presentation here, we have the links to the certificates there, and you can later then have a look on those. So we intend what we want the user to utilize the maps for is as a qualitative standard in a broad range of applications. So you see it here mentioned, internal assay control is of course possible, but also as an independent control material later then all the time in the bracketing fields there, you can use it as a control material for method development, but also later to see that the method is still running stable over the whole time of the analytical run. And that can be for a lot of physicochemical testing here. On the intact mass, we come to that later again. Also charge heterogeneity, the size variance, and then very important also the glycan analysis, of course. And it can standardize that about across laboratories so that you can see if one laboratory works well with the method and the reference standard in there, then it can show that maybe that method was nicely transferred from the sending laboratory to the receiving one. So also for method development, validation, but also for method transfer, these reference standards can be used a lot. I mentioned already that we did rigorously tested those materials by the chapters 129 and also 210 and 212, and then put that information on the certificates. And we also did that in an interlaboratory study here, so that the materials are very very well characterized. Not on the certificates, but there is also a technical note that is not shown, which is not shown on our website yet, but I will send that with the email out to you. I will send that technical note as a PDF as well to you, where we have additional data for these three monoclonal antibodies, such as the intact mass and then oligosaccharides, a little bit more information there on the oligosaccharides, and then also capillary isoelectric focusing there as well on. And we have further applications under exploration, as you can see here. And once we have data for that, we will also then extend the certificate and also issue new tech notes. That's also what we have in mind for that. So let's have a quick look into some of the features that the monoclonal antibodies have. So here you see the size exclusion chromatography example from the general chapter 129 here for all the maps here. So you can see them here. Based on what I said, based on the chapter 129, and you can see when you look on the first map on map 01001, you can see that this one is having the most complex high molecular weight species fraction here coming eluting before the monomer, for example. So this is maybe a very good map that helps you to develop your method so that you can resolve and get that same picture on your with your method than on that map, for example. And the map 2 and 3 is showing better resolution here between the monomer and the aggregate, so that can also be very helpful there for you. And I mentioned already how you can use this, for example, on the system suitability criteria, that you check that the method, that your method is running stable and consistent over the whole series, in that you check in the bracketing injections always with that precision control or that performance verification control here on the reference standards. So basically, the users here can utilize their own methods and define also the system suitability criteria here based on the chromatographic similarity. So, and then you can show the consistency of your chromatogram. That is here for size exclusion chromatography. It's also possible here with capillary electrophoresis. Here in this case, we have the data for the reducing conditions. So you see, for example, here, again, from chapter 12, 129, you see, for example, here on the on the map number one, that the level of the non-glycolated heavy chain here is very, very low. So this material would be ideal to test the method sensitivity, for example. And also you can check on the resolution, of course, with all of the maps between the non-glycolated heavy chain and the heavy chain. Here, after having reduced the antibody, of course, and there you can use the materials for system suitability criteria, for example, like the resolution, but also the ratio of the non-glycolated heavy chain to the total heavy chain, for example. Right, and then we have the same here for capillary electrophoresis under non-reducing conditions here. And you can see here on this one that the map number three is having the lowest purity for the IgG main peak, but has a very complex range of impurities. And to have a method that can resolve all these impurity peaks here from the low molecular weight species side, the fragment side, and that is of course also a very important feature. So map number three can probably be used a lot for method development and then also qualification. Then yeah. So that's what we have here for the product related impurities. We also have, but that is not on the certificates yet, but it's in the tech note. We also have here capillary isoelectric focusing data in the tech note for all maps, and you can also see, which is not in the tech note yet, also the mirror image on the bottom here for imaged capillary isoelectric focusing. So ICIF. Sorry, I'm stumbling here. ICIEF there as well, which is the newer technique and is a quicker technique, of course, because you don't need anymore to elute once again all the basic acidic peaks and all the charge variants from the column with the normal from the capillary from the normal CIEF technique. CIEF is also quite useful for checking on the stability. So we are recently undergoing, these are preliminary data, but we are undergoing here stability studies. And when it's finalized, we will also make that data available. But you can see already here that our map, especially that one, but it is hopefully the same for all maps that we have now, that we have here, room temperature for 4 weeks, that the material is stable there. And it is a solution. I have not said that it was shown further on the slide, but I didn't before on the slide, and I haven't mentioned it. But this is in solution. We have those reference standards in solution directly. It's not lyophilized. So the materials at room temperature for 4 weeks are quite stable here. So this is about the charge variants, where we have information here in the tech note, and then let's come to the important section of glycolization here, and this is a topic, of course, as you know, which is very complex and very variable. It's not template directed, the protein glycolization I mentioned already. The template is running the protein setting up, decoding, and excretion. Excretion is the wrong word here, but it's set up, of course, in the ribosomes, in the reticulum, but it's undergoing then post-translational modification afterwards by the interaction of many enzymes and substrates, and also by chemical influences. And it very, very much depends on the cell line factors, also on the culture conditions, and even later by purification. So the whole downstream process is also important there on the glycolization. So that means that there's a large possibility of significant variability there, batch to batch, and if manufacturing is changing here, and even then, and also on the important field of biosimilars, that is of course also a very large topic. How is the glycosylation pattern of the reference product? And normally you want, of course, with a biosimilar product, come as close to that glycosylation pattern as it is to the to the reference product. So what can you do to check on glycosylation? We have for that, we have the chapter 1084, where analysis strategies can be set up with. So you can analyze at the intact glycoprotein level, for example, the intact mass there with MALDI and easy mass spectrometry. You see here those highlighted in green. We will explain this information a little bit. So we will explain, or we have data for our MAPS with this techniques in our certificate and also in the tech notes here. Very important is, however, also not at the intact level, but at the level of the cleaved glycans. So with the chapter 212, that is telling you how to cleave the glycans from your monoclonal antibody. And then, for example, how to analyze that with fluorophore labeling and then capillary electrophoresis. That is what we do also in with our monoclonal antibodies there. And then also very important on the sialic acid point for the sialic acid is the analysis on the monosaccharide level. We will come to that also in a second once more. So this is showing the data that we have on the certificates and also in the tech notes for the intact mass here. I don't want to go into detail, but when you assume N-terminal pyroglutamation and C-terminal lysine truncation, then the pattern that you would get here, the interpretation that you can make here is shown there and showing here that you have the different mixtures of the MAPS with the different glycosylation patterns here. So that is shown here, and you can use that, of course, also to check if your mass testing is running in the right way. So I don't want to go too much into detail here. This is also I mentioned this is here to check that the releasing of the glycans is working, that you can evaluate that method in your laboratory for this technique and feature. We have the following information on the certificates here. this was done by, I mentioned it already, by capillary electrophoresis. And then we have laser-induced fluorescence there in order to make to make them visible, the peaks then visible. But that is a very normal technique. So that's the glycan analysis. We also have sialic acid on there. and you see here that we are expressing that sialic acid content as the molar ratio of sialic acid to the protein. And we check then on the level of the Nu5AC and the Nu5GC. Both sialic acid variants, we are checking on that. And you can see that we have very low levels in our MAPS for the Nu5AC and could not detect the Nu5GC in our MAPS here. So and that is an important feature that is also it's a very critical quality attribute, because the level of Nu5GC is showing how much. So you always want to have, I'm probably just stating the obvious, but for me it's very interesting information. So with a level of Nu5GC, you can see how how much immunogenicity you can expect, because it is hinting to a strong animal part still in the cell lines. As you know, we humans cannot produce Nu5GC, but are just producing Nu5AC and have that in our proteins, in our MAPS itself as well. So a low level of Nu5GC is also very, very important to have low immunogenicity characteristics on your molecule as well. So that is also a very important feature here. And then we have also, of course, the chapters itself with which we have tested the maps from that you have seen before. So there's the chapter 212 that we discussed already a little bit. It's here explained. We have also to check that the method is running in the right way. We have also the system suitability mixtures that you can see here on the slides, and also linked here to those system suitability mixtures are the certificates, the USP certificates, so that you can have an idea what we provide there with information. There's also some more information about where the oligosaccharides are coming from. We have here, you see it here, mixture A is coming from a polyclonal IgG. Oligosaccharide mixture B is coming from, so we release that from RNAS B. Mixture C is from alpha acid, from an alpha acid glucoprotein, and the mixture D is from phetoene. You see the properties mentioned here. I don't want to go too much into detail here. You can see it later once again. Also, one information, this link at the bottom is going to an article that we have recently published, or just in August it was published, and it's showing additional N-glycans identified in the mixtures for A and B. So there we have, let me just have a look again, we have there we went from 9 identified glycan parts, we went up to assigning 30 overall now. So from 9, we went up to 30 N-glycans connected to 32 peaks that we have there. And in the case of mixture B, we have there 16 N-glycan isoforms newly assigned, where it was 5 before here. So that is very interesting. So I can very much recommend to read that article and maybe apply the same methods there. So we could show with that article, with the techniques that we used there. We used their Helig and UHPLC coupled with QTOF here, and could show there that the USB mix A, number A, is showing a very nice and good representation of cell-related, galactosylated, and fucosylated N-linked lichens, and a better representation, broader representation than we have on comparable commercial glycan libraries. That is what we are saying in that article. So please have a look there as well if you're interested in that. And then the chapter 210, once again, we mentioned it already, that the information is on the certificate here as well. And we have there also for that chapter on the monosaccharide level, the reference standards available that is used together with that chapter, the two for the more human new 5AC and the new 5GC reference standards here. Okay, and with that, I am already at the future standards, and I don't want to go too much into detail here. We consider to expand our focus beyond the specific product classes. So we are evaluating right now a lot of standards for technologies and assays with a broad application and also a broad impact. You can see the technologies and the assays mentioned here. I don't want to read through them right now, also in the interest of time, to have time enough for questions and answers, in which Anu and Dr. Ranjan are supporting here. We also, just one mentioning here with that slide, we also are exploring multi-attribute methods here to get provide more efficient and comprehensive protein characterization. So MAMIS is a very important technique. You can monitor multiple CQAs there in one single assay with mass spectrometry, and it's very, very important. And we are currently evaluating several MAP materials using this approach, and hope that we have a standard for that in the future available as well. But that is still a long way down before we come to that. So thank you very much for joining me today. I I hope I could make it a little bit clear that biotherapeutic standards from USP can work for you. We have developed them using a rigorous scientific process and multi-lab collaborative studies here. And I hope it will provide a consistent benchmark for our users in the analytical testing throughout the product life cycle. And what I would also like to make you aware of is our recent quality methods blog. I have linked here to that one as well, where my colleague, Dr. Anu Upal, who is also supporting me in the question session now here, is also, together with a colleague, is talking about the very important glycolization issues. So, and with that, I thank you already for your attention, and would like to get your questions. So I forgot to mention that. Please type your questions in the question field so that we can address them. Right. So let's see if there are already some questions in. Let me go to the.
So we haven't received any questions yet, Krishan. I was checking into and I posted in the chat box as well.
Ah, okay. Yeah, I see it also here. But here we have now, there's one question. Ah, yeah, there's one question coming in now, Anu. What are the INN, the international non-proprietary names of the maps? Would you like to say something about that? I can do it as well. We don't let me start first. We don't mention the INNs of the maps that were used for creating the three monoclonal antibodies. We provide, however, the CAS number in the certificates and also on the web shop. You can see already the certificates, so from there you can conclude. But it is our policy not to name them directly. So that was one of the questions there. Exactly, it was just one question so far. Anu, would you like to add something to that information?
Yeah, thank you. So I would just encourage participants to ask more questions, because this is the time you can clarify your doubts if you have anything related to these MAB standards. But what I would like to say is that these standards are basically broadly applicable standards. They are not, though they are not related to any of the USP chapter or monograph, but these standards have been verified using the chapter 129, chapter 212, and 210 for glycan analysis. So you have some methods, starting methods to work on using these standards, but you are free to use any of your in-house validated standards. So what's the advantage of using these standards is that these MAP standards you can use for, optimizing your methods. I mean, whenever you are, transferring your method from R&D to QC lab, or you are doing any tech transfer to a third party, you are outsourcing your sample analysis, often you feel challenges that whether the data being shared, whether it's replicated or not, is your method optimized? Are you facing any challenges? So these standards can work as an external independent control, which can help you in optimizing these conditions, especially when you are doing, multi-lab study or transferring your method from one lab to another. And these are not specific to just one technique, like what Krishan has already showed, multiple techniques like size exclusion, CSDS under reduced, non-reduced conditions, so for impurity profiling, for intact mass, the mass spectrometric analysis. And I would just like to add in there is that this is just the preliminary data. We are working on getting more of the data, but that doesn't restrict you in using these standards for other techniques. So right now, like what Krishan has showed is the data for intact mass, but this can also be used for reduced MAP or peptide mapping. So you are free to optimize or use your own methods using these standards.
Thank you very
much. I have got some more questions.
Yes, yeah. I see that as well. So we also have one question or maybe even two questions in the chat box that came in. So maybe I can read that out to you, Anu. There's one question: how does our standards or these standards meet other national standards, such as those from the World Health Organization?
So as far as I know, for these antibody standards, there is no WHO standard for physicochemical characterization. The standard what we have is for potency assays, and those are product specific ones. So this is a general IgG class 1 applicable standards. And we have got three standards so that you can choose the molecule based on the charge variant analysis and impurity profile, like which one is more suitable to your molecule. So, but WHO mainly, they don't have these physicochemical standards as far as I know. They do have some potency standards. Maybe Dr. Ranjan, if you would like to add in there.
Yeah, I think, you know, WHO, what NABSC does for WHO are mostly the potency standard, and there is, they don't develop physicochemical standard, because I was a part of those WHO committees who were working on this biosimilar standard. So that's a discussion we have. So WHO left it for pharmacopeia to develop these standards for physicochemical analysis. And another question where you, I think, Christine, there is a question where I see that how are USP working in partnership with EPJP, CHP? Do you want to give that answer? Do you mean
me, Ranjan?
So I can answer that. We have a PDG group where all of these pharmacopeias work together. USP, EPJP are very active member of that group, and CHP has recently joined there, and they are also now an active member. So we try to discuss among ourselves and see how much what we call, I think you use the word aligned, what is called as the harmonized methods. But I think it is easy to say this harmonization, because you understand the requirement of each region many times has come out are different, and thereby the pharmacopeias also want to stick to their region's requirement, because the regulatory requirements are not same in all the places. So that's why you will see a difference, although we are trying, we meet regularly and try to see how much we can harmonize. But if you are talking about the testing methods, generally the methods which are used are common, because as Christine has mentioned, because these methods are based on the CQS. So based on the CQA, you want to figure it, you want to analyze, you have the standard methods there. So I don't think that you will see a big difference in the methods for specific CQS. But of course, the specifications and acceptance criteria, they vary based on the regulatory requirements of each region.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ranjan. There's another question.
Somebody asked about the training. You can respond to that.
Yes. Yeah. It was also talked. I see that the question as well showing up here. About training on the methods, like we do dissolution training. I cannot answer that question at this point. Do you have any information, Dr. Ranjan or Anu, if we provide training for or are thinking about providing training?
No. So basically, we do have different training programs, but related to specifically the analytical characterization, what methods you have shown in your presentation. Right now, we don't have any plans for that training program, but we do have other training programs related to QC. So, I mean, they can visit our website for that. So there are some training programs available. Other thing is the methods, what you showed, are listed in the chapter 1 to 9, which is the analytical procedures for monoclonal antibody characterization. So they can always refer to those chapters for the method details.
Yeah, I think I'll just add up a little bit. There are some, I think, on-demand training on 129. And also we are developing a training on the glycan analysis as per chapter 210. So I think Christian can work with us and then see that how we can take it to your region. And the second thing is we are in the final stage of developing a training on method development and validation for biotherapeutics, which also I think will be available. So in next 2 to 3 months, I think a couple of these will be available. And so Christian, you can follow up with your stakeholders and then figure it out how you can get it delivered those courses.
Thank you, Dr. Ranjan, for mentioning that. I forgot to mention about that. So basically, I'm working on that course for method development. So that is specifically for highlighting the analytical considerations for the method development and validation for biotherapeutics.
Yeah. We have another question here. If we plan to extend our standards also to different antibody isotype classes in the near future, or to maybe more complex biologics as well?
Yeah, we are thinking about that, considering the different types like IgG2, IgG4, but it's really, I mean, we are thinking and in the planning stage for that. So right now it's difficult to say that by when they will be available, but yes, the plan is there.
Yeah, and, thank you very
Christian,
much.
You missed, there were a few more questions above this question. Basically, someone asked, Mr. Thomas has asked that, are the standards lyophilized and how are the how are they stored, 2 to 8 degree? How much do you have in stock considering availability of the same standard?
Exactly. So, that would have been my next question I asked to you, Yo, but please go ahead.
So these standards are provided in the formulation buffer, and information about the formulation buffer is given in the certificates. So Christian will be sharing the presentation which has linked to all the certificates, so you can get the information about the formulation buffer. And storage also is given there. So what we recommend is that you can aliquot that and then store it in -20 if you want to use it for long. And yes, we do have a huge quantity of stock available with us, and it is from the same lot. So you really don't have to worry about the lot-to-lot variability. So in future, this will be available, I think, for next 5-10 years, something like that.
Yeah, we also have one more question I can see here. What are health authorities' expectations towards companies already producing biologics when a new USP standard is available for this specific biological, probably? Is there internal evaluation of newly established USP standards toward in-house standards obligatory?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. And one thing I would like to clarify, that when you are doing a biosimilar development or characterization, you anyways need to show the biosimilarity with the innovator product. So, and you will have to have your in-house reference standard for showing the comparison for establishing the biosimilarity and comparability studies. The USP standards, these USP standards are basically the system suitability standard, which you can use to demonstrate the, you know, I mean, this will help you in establishing whether the differences what you are getting is because of the experimental differences or because of the product differences. Because even if you are working with your innovator molecule and you are establishing biosimilarity over a longer period of time, even innovator molecule tends to undergo changes, right? So then in certain scenarios, it becomes difficult to explain whether the differences observed are because of the experimental variation or because of the product variation. So in that case, these standards will help you in establishing the system suitability criteria over a longer period of time without undergoing modification. And even these standards you can use for completely characterizing your in-house reference standard. So please do not consider this that these standards will replace your innovator molecule with which you need to show the compatibility. Regulators demand that you need to establish your biosimilarity with the innovator molecule. That is for there. But these USP standards will help you in minimizing the experimental variations, in generating the data over a longer period of time, which will help you in convincing regulators that whatever variations or these tight specifications you are setting, those are very well meeting with these standards.
Thank you, Anu. I see one more question here. I think I can answer that one. Are the biotherapeutic standards aligned with other standards from other geographies? When it is about the documentary standards that I explained in the presentation, 129 to 10 and to 12, for example, and also the other ones above 1000, these are at this stage not aligned with standards from other geographies, from other pharmacopeias, for example. That that could be in the future, could be one of our goals, depends on what other pharmacopeias would do, but at the moment they are not aligned, so they are not harmonized. Dr. Ranjan mentioned already pharmacopeia discussion group before, but this is so far not done. Yeah, I think with that I can see no more.
No, there is one question. I think two are linked. Yeah,
about I see this one.
Invalidity rates are high in bio labs. Further investment in its standardization of method is asked.
Yeah.
And if survey was run on the QC bio methods and the rate of invalidity could be understood and training via WebEx developed. The pharmacopoeias need to develop into video.
Yeah. That's I saw this comment as well. That are very nice comments. Thank you very much to the participant who answered it or who posed the questions or the comment. I will get in contact with the participant that gave these comments and maybe we can start some cooperation from there. These are very valid comments. I can only agree to that. There's also one more question. I think we cannot answer that really very well, but let's try. How much variation is allowed or accepted between a biosimilar and an innovator product? Is that something you want to comment on?
This is really a difficult question to ask, and this is something it depends on the manufacturer. It depends on the processes employed. It depends upon molecule to molecule. So you really need to understand your molecule, what kind of processes you are putting into place, the innovator molecule specifications. So that is where, people say process defines the product. So based on that only, you need to, set up the specifications, develop the molecule, and depend on that only, we can consider that how much variation can be allowed in there. So this is something like we really can't comment on that, but as a manufacturer, you need to understand your processes and molecule and define the acceptance limits or specifications criterias?
Yeah, so I can just add on to that. See, this is something which you need to talk to the regulators, because you know this is based on the regulator's expectation where you have to decide. But one thing, as Anu was telling, you know, if you are a biosimilar developer, the first thing what you do is you collect several batches of innovator product at different stages of that. I mean, some are at the early stage, some are near to expiry date, and like that, because you know very well there are several publications that with change in the manufacturing process, change in manufacturing site, and based on how close it is to the expiry date, the innovator products also vary. And so that's why, that's where you need to collect those huge number of samples and then go ahead and do a full study of each of the CQAs and then figure it out what kind of variation you are seeing with the innovator product. And based on that, you decide on the specs that what are the kind of variation you see in the innovator product. And based on that, you take your product and then try to convince the regulator that I have seen this kind of variation in the innovator product. This is in the market. It didn't show any kind of huge toxicity or immunogenicity or any kind of thing, because end of the day, regulator want that, they are concerned on the safety and efficacy. So if you can prove with that yes, my variation, my product variation is within that range, and we know very well it is in the market, it's in clinic, and there is no issue so far reported, then maybe you can convince the regulator. But this is, as Anu said, this is of your understanding of the innovator product range, and also place it properly to the regulator and convince regulator that your product lies within the range and it will not there is no difference in the efficacy, and there is no safety concern.
Yeah, and just to add in there, I mean, if you're working on a biosimilar molecule, just remember the inverted triangle. The more you invest in the collecting the analytical data, the more you characterize your molecule better, you understand your molecule better, it will be easy. I mean, it's a database evidence approach. So the more, you know, a number of batches, the different analytical techniques characterizing your molecule better, it will be easy for you to convince the regulators.
Okay. I don't think we have too much more time for questions. We are almost out of questions anyway. The other questions I will address directly to those that are asked for. Maybe to go back to one question in the chat. Where do I find detailed analytical report in the USP store? You will find the certificates, of course, of all the reference standards also when you go into the USP store and click through there to the specific reference standards. I will, however, provide the presentation to the participants. You will also find the links there to the MAP certificates. In there, you will also find the link to the article that I explained, and to the Quality Matters blog from Dr. Anu. That is in there. And I will also add the technical note, which I mentioned, I will add to the email, because that technical note is not yet on our website. As far as I know, last week it was not yet on. And and that answers also the other question that we had there still in the chat function, in the checkbox, if we are able to provide that presentation. Yes, we are able to provide that presentation, and I will share it with the participants either today or tomorrow. And there you have then all the links and also the technical note. And with that, Ranjan?
One more thing maybe I just thought to share, that we are planning to do a round robin study, where we want to work with several laboratories across the globe to generate more data, because I could see one question on that, of each of these techniques and also some of the additional uses of these monoclonal antibodies. So if any of these people who are today as participant here, if they are interested in that, they can reach out to you and then you can figure it out how exactly they can take part in that round of study.
Yes, thank you for pointing that out, Ranjan. Yes, absolutely. If you are interested in that, please reach out to me. My email is mentioned. My email address is mentioned at the end of the presentation. So please reach out to me, and I will see that I connect you to the right people in order to participate there. With having said that, yeah, we have filled that hour. Thank you very much to the participants for joining us today and investing the time of 1 hour to go with us through this webinar and the question and answer section. And thank you also, Dr. Ranjan and Dr. Anu, once again for participating from India and supporting our EMEA office here in doing that webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you all for participating. And bye-bye all. See you at the next webinar in 2 weeks. Hopefully, bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you.